JKB back with another episode. Today on the show, I'm reviewing Rogue Heroes, Ruins of Tasos. Thank you so much to Team 17 for the review copy. On the surface, Rogue Heroes can be considered a Link to the Past clone. However, they introduce roguelike mechanics into this gameplay and tons of RPG goodness. At the beginning of the game, you have a choice of icon color, and that is kind of important because you will be playing with other people online or locally up to 4 players, and that's something that's kind of really unique about this because it reminded me of Link to the Past or Legend of Zelda, but also the Four Swords adventures that Nintendo released for the Game Boy Advance. Now, the easiest way to describe this game is it's a Link to the Past, except I wouldn't say the story goes even a fraction as deep as a Link to the Past goes. You have an overworld map that you can discover freely by just simply walking around. Your character will have a sword in the beginning, but you have a ton of different abilities that you will level up as you play the game. Now, the roguelite aspects of the game are centered around the dungeons. When you go into the first dungeon, there's 3 floors of difficulty. As you get deeper into it, or I should say higher into the dungeon, you will notice that the enemies are stronger and they move quicker. And this is where the roguelite comes into effect, because if you die, you get to keep all of the gems that you've collected out of that dungeon, and you can spend them by retrieving your soul back in the village on new buildings, or, you know, leveling up your character, or, you know, the speed of attack, or that sort of thing. All of those roguelite, you know, core gameplay elements that you really know and love from other roguelite games are here in this game. Now, the bad news is, if you try to go back in the dungeon to complete that dungeon and you still have gems left, well, you gotta pay to get in that dungeon and you lose all of your gems. So if you've never experienced a roguelike game, this is a great place to start because of its inspiration of Link to the Past, but also because the first dungeon is a bit of a grind. It's teaching you how to get into the gameplay. And once you start to get into the next levels of that, and you collect more gems and go back to the town and upgrade your abilities and all that stuff, you'll start to realize, like, the gameplay loop in this game is tremendous. Combat is exactly the same, but it feels a little loose, but it does get tightened as you upgrade your abilities, but I should say it feels like a Link to the Past. The idea of the game is go in the dungeons, get some loot, come out, spend that loot. The difference here is, though, it feels really loose at the beginning. Your character is sliding all over the place. It feels like it's something not really well made, but you start to understand that as you upgrade your character, you will notice things are getting a little bit tighter and gameplay is starting to feel great, and you start to get into this rhythm of go into the dungeon, kill enemies, get loot, spend the coins, or gems. It's a great gameplay loop. Another cool part of combat in the game is that you have a stamina meter above you, which means you can't simply sit there and bash on the attack button. You actually have to wait in between a certain amount of attacks, and your character will get slower as you do more attacks, and they'll lose their breath. And you can hear them on screen gasping for air if you continuously hit the attack button. So you actually have to wait for them to gain their breath back to be able to attack again. And I think that is an amazing aspect of this game because it makes it much harder and it gives you more of a sense of strategy built into the mechanics, because you can't go into a level and just bash the shit out of everything. You have to plan your attacks with some sort of strategy in mind. One of the coolest aspects of the game is the ability to change your character's theme from just being a regular balanced person to a couple of different choices right off the bat. Once you unlock this village, you'll start to see that the game is opening up because it introduces new characters that give you new upgrade trees. So not only are you upgrading your weapons or making them stronger, or you're getting potions from somebody, or you're building houses so more people come into the town so you can do side missions on the overworld. It's not just that. At one point you unlock the ability to change your class, and I'm not going to go into all of them here, but you know you've got the usual thief and, you know, knight, which has better armor. So now you start to see how the game's opening up, right? You start the game as a simple dude just going on about your business with a sword, and you end up being this knight who has strong armor and and has the ability to take more hits. So you switch between those based on which dungeon you're going in. If you were a fan of Four Swords, the Legend of Zelda game that was released originally on the Game Boy Advance, then you're going to be in heaven here, because you could spend so much time with your friends going into these dungeons, defeating bosses. Yes, there's bosses as well. When you get to the end of the dungeon, you have to defeat a gigantic boss. The boss battles are heavily inspired, once again, by A Link to the Past. So let me get into the pros and cons of this game. Replayability is the highest pro on this list. I mean, it is ridiculously addictive. I mean, you go back in these dungeons, get the loot, go back to town, upgrade your characters, and do all sorts of things in the town. There's fishing, there's side quests, there's just simple exploring with secrets all over the open world. It is ridiculous at times how deep the game does actually feel, being a pretty, you know, budget title here at around, I think, $19 US and maybe $25 in Canada here. This game is like a must-own for roguelite players. I mean, I don't know how else to explain it. It is a must-own. Another pro is the couch co-op multiplayer. I mean, it's ridiculous. I mean, it's going right back in time to the good old days of playing just these simple little games like A Link to the Past or even Four Swords on your Game Boy Advance with the, you know, the connection cable between the systems. It brings you back into that, and you feel great playing these games, and you feel an achievement when you defeat one of these dungeons. Now, let me just point out something here. This game is difficult. You will be dying a lot. You'll be getting sent back to town. That's when you start to open up the village by building new houses on that village. And after a couple of hours, you'll have, you know, a little town with people just running around and animals and all of these extra missions to do, and the game just keeps opening up. And of course, the game features tons of puzzles within the dungeons, and I have to say this, some of them are a little tricky to figure out, and it kind of reminded me again of Link to the Past and figuring those out for the first time again. The game also looks and sounds pretty good. There's some sound effects that are clearly inspired by Legend of Zelda. The game, in terms of its visuals, I kind of feel like, yeah, it's getting a little close to the border of being, I don't know, you know what they say out there, right? Good artist steal. So, yeah, I'll leave it at that. In terms of the cons, I would say that the story isn't necessarily that deep. It's very simple, and I really don't think it's a huge con, but I would have liked to see something a little bit deeper. Would have made the game feel a little bit more special. And I have to also say that the skill trees and upgrade paths for your character and the town, they get out of hand at times. I mean, it doesn't necessarily make sense that there's so many of the same paths. And I don't know why that is. I guess it's because they want you to spend more money in those areas. But it's just confusing at first. I'm like, why is there two different abilities to level up your character in terms of the strength? So you do one of them and they cost, like, it goes from 60 to 120 to 180, 240. And you're like, okay, that makes sense. As you upgrade the character, it's going to cost more to get them more powerful. But then all of a sudden there's another skill tree that's exactly the same as that, but it's cheaper. And they've got two of them running parallel, and it's confusing. And that's really the only two things I can come up with in terms of the negatives of this game. If you're a fan of Link to the Past and rogue light games out there, you're going to be in love with this game. It's one of these, well, no pun intended, hidden gems, because you collect gems in the game, but it really is a hidden gem. If you got a Switch, it's like a must own. I'm going to give it like an 8.5 out of 10, say. This is a game you have to pick up and play for yourself. It's perfect for the Nintendo Switch, just to play a couple of hours here and there, slowly build up your characters, build up your town to unlock new abilities for your characters, and then go into new dungeons to experience new enemy battles. These enemies, by the way, I should add, are pretty unique to the game. I was a little impressed by this. There was one enemy where you had to throw a bomb at the outer shell of the casing on the enemy to be able to actually hit the enemy. So you'd throw a bomb, it would explode the enemy, but it wouldn't kill it, it would just remove its armor. So you would be able to attack it. And you've got skeletons that can throw bones, and you can deflect them after you get the deflection upgrade, of course. But this I can just go on. I mean, this game is really that good. So if you're into roguelites, you're into Legend of Zelda, wow, go out and get this right away. Thank you so much for watching. If you want to know anything more about the game, let me know in the comments below, and I'll see you in the next episode of JKB.